This evening on the Rock Newman Show, I have a conversation with well-renowned activist and founder of Hope House DC, Carol Fennelly. Carol discusses her longtime fight against homelessness alongside late activist Mitch Snyder and how she's carrying on his legacy and mission combating poverty and aiding families fractured by mass incarceration. That's coming up right now on the Rock Newman Show. Welcome to the Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Carol Fennelly is a long-standing advocate for the homeless community here in Washington, D.C. As a colleague and companion of famed activist Mitch Snyder, Carol helped provide housing for thousands of impoverished people. In the wake of Snyder's death in 1990, she continued their efforts and has since founded Hope House DC, an organization designed to keep incarcerated fathers connected with their kids. This angel joins me now to discuss her continued fight on the front lines of activism. Carol, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
Did you just put your wings and just fly on in?
Oh, God. You know, Dorothy Day founded the Catholic Worker Movement, and there was a guy at the Catholic Worker Movement named Stanley Bishnewski, who was there until he died, and he was there for like 50 years. And he said of Dorothy Day, who was being talked about for canonization in the Catholic Church, that there are martyrs and there are saints. It takes martyrs to live with saints.
All right. You're a martyr or a saint, or both?
I'm probably a saint because it takes a martyr to live with me. So.
Yes. We mentioned in the top of the program here your longtime relationship with Mitch Snyder.
Yes.
We certainly want to talk about that. Here's what I want to do. I want to get a little background because you are someone that has been such an institution in the D.C. community that... And you know, untold articles are written about you. You can't even house your awards that you've gotten for your humanitarian efforts. But I want folks to know even a little more about Carol Fennelly. So let's go way back. Let's go way back to where. Talk to me about your childhood and where you grew up and what your early influences were.
I grew up in California, and
what part?
Southern California.
Okay.
Where else?
Okay.
You know, I was a beach girl and lived on a farm in the San Diego area. And as soon as I turned 18, graduated from high school, I was gone and became a hippie. You know, and traveled around the country. At one point, some friends and I hitchhiked by airplane trying to get to the Bahamas and ended up stuck in Chicago because no one would take us anywhere. But we got to Chicago from California.
Now, when you say hitchhike?
By airplane.
Yeah.
So you go to private airports and you ask private airplane owners for rides. But I looked about 12.
Yeah.
And so they were afraid of carrying a minor across the state line, didn't believe I was 18. And, so we got as far as Chicago and then couldn't get any rides. And I ended up having to work and earn an airline ticket to come back. So, but it was an adventure, you know.
And so would you say that you're, because you've done some things that people would consider insane, real crazy, extraordinarily brave. Did you have that just sort of unfiltered sense of adventure from early on?
Probably not. I wouldn't say that. I don't come from a family of adventurers.
Okay.
And I think that... Once I got my wings at 18, I became adventurous and just, you know, wasn't what I was looking for. I just wanted to find out what was going on around me. And
So you got grounded there in Chicago. You worked for a while to get an airline ticket. Did you take it back to San Diego, or did you go off somewhere else?
I came back to California and ended up hitchhiking up and down the California coast, and I was picked up by this guy who lived in a commune, and so I went there and I stayed there for a while, and that's where I met my first husband, and
You really lived the hippie life.
I did.
Yeah.
I did. My daughter's name is Sunshine. It was 1969.
Yeah.
I mean, you know.
Yeah.
I thought flower power would last forever.
That's right.
Now she's a chief of staff for a member of Congress, and her name is Carrie Sunshine. So she goes by Carrie now. I thought I'd better give her a real first name, right, just in case.
And so, when did you matriculate to the Washington, D.C. area?
I came to Washington in 1976, I think.
Okay.
So about 40 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And initially I moved in with a Sojourner community, which is a faith community, but you know, they live together, an intentional community.
Mm-hmm.
So my hippie commune, only stayed there a few months, and then moved on to the community for creative nonviolence, where I stayed for 17 years.
Uh-huh.
But my kids were with me at that point, kind of.
And your kids were how old then?
They were 5 and 7 when we first came to D.C.
Uh-huh. And so you went to the CC...
NV.
NV.
Community for Creative Nonviolence.
Yes. And, I mean, what was it that took you there?
Well, I initially came to Washington thinking, I'd read an article in Sojourners, and I kind of confused the work of CCNV with Sojourners.
Uh-huh.
And so I wanted to track them down when I got here.
Yeah.
And I met Mitch, you know, shortly after I got here, and moved to CCNV.
Uh-huh. So you met him while you were at Sojourners?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
And of course, when you say Mitch, you're talking about the famed Mitch Snyder.
Correct.
Yes. Love at first sight?
Absolutely. I actually saw a picture of him and fell in love with his picture. I mean, I just was a smitten, you know?
Yeah.
I can't even describe it. I still have the picture hanging on my wall that I saw. And actually, I saw the picture, I believe, in Sojourners.
Uh-huh.
And then I met him, and at an event we were having after a demonstration, we just had Sojourners and CCNV had joint efforts, and I met him on a picket line.
Uh-huh.
And then he was at the party, and he was standing out in the front porch smoking a cigarette, you know, his pell-mells, his filterless pell-mells.
Yeah.
And I didn't smoke, but I went out so I could talk to him. I didn't know what to say.
Yeah.
And so I asked him for a cigarette, pell-mells.
So he had, and he had developed a reputation even at that time.
Yes. Mm-hmm. It wasn't as widespread outside of D.C., but yes, within D.C. he had,
Mm-hmm.
And so I smoked that stupid pell-mell so I could talk to him. I mean, seriously? You ever smoked a pell-mell? Oh.
I tried to smoke a Camel when I was 14 years old.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I haven't smoked since, right?
Yeah. No, that's right. That's right.
Yeah, so that's how we met, and, you know, the rest was history.
Mm-hmm. Sort of, I mean, after you met there, what was it? I mean, was it sort of just like you guys became inseparable?
I don't know, inseparable, you know, but there was definitely, you know, we definitely began a relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And so.
And so, one of the really famous stories that I remember about you guys' activism, and became aware of it, you know, just while it was going in real time.
Yeah.
Was, and I need you to tell this story because it's so relevant what is now 46 years later.
Mm-hmm.
You all had a building, or had thought you were getting a building. You know what? I'm not going to try to do it. You do it. And what I'm talking about ultimately was Ronald Reagan came in, a Republican administration came in, like has just recently come in now.
Right.
You know, with a much more conservative ideology.
Right, right.
And you all had access, or were promised, or something like that, a building for the homeless.
Well, not exactly.
Okay.
You're talking about the 2nd and D Street building, the big shelter.
Yeah.
We had a a drop-in center over on G Street where people could come in and, you know, get dinner and hang out and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
And we were losing the lease on the building. So we were in search of a new place to live.
Yeah.
And so someone in our community came back and said, hey, there's this cool building on 2nd and D Street. It's for lease. It's a federal building. Yeah. Or not for lease. It's up for auction. So we got all dressed up in suits and grown-up clothes and pretended we wanted, made an appointment to see the building and pretended we wanted to buy it. And Mitch wasn't well enough, enough known at that point to be recognized by the people who took us on a tour. And when we left, we went, wow, we got to have that building. And so we started a campaign to get it. Now, previous to that, there had been a number of congressional hearings and you know, Ronald Reagan was getting pressed on homelessness. And so we asked that, well, a number of us, a number of groups came together and asked that the federal government create a list of unused federal buildings that could be used as homeless shelters, create a list, and, you know, so that people could apply for those buildings. And this was a federal building. And that list was around for years. When you try and call, you know, to get somebody to talk to about a new building, nobody answered the phone. This went on for years. And so finally we said, here's a federal building and we're going to get it. And so we, you know, had a campaign. We got the building. I think it was December 23rd in the early, I'm not sure of the year exactly. I think it would have been 83. And I mean, it was a long case. Susan Baker was very involved in helping us. The wife of James Baker was very involved in helping us get the building. And we were only supposed to get it for a period
of time. James Baker at the time was Reagan's Secretary of State.
We were only supposed to get it for, like, just for the winter. So we held a press conference on the 23rd and said, we need a building. And because homeless people don't have a place to stay, so we went back to our house, and that night we got a call from Oliver Carr. Is this the story you're talking about? We got a call from Oliver Carr, and Oliver Carr said, "I have a hotel in downtown Washington, and I'm going to let you use it. We're going to tear it down, but for right now, it's just sitting there vacant." And
Oliver Carr, big developer, in the D.C. area.
And you can have it, you know, for now. And so we had been promised the building at that, the shelter at that point, but it still needed some work. So we weren't going to be able to move in on Christmas Eve, which was always a very special night for us. So on the 24th, we had to go down, and the building had big holes in the windows where there had been air conditioning units. And so we had to go down and cover up all those holes with cardboard and wood and everything. And Oliver was great. He filled the tank with oil so we could heat the building. We had no beds, so we got, the Army gave us cots and blankets. You remember Dominique? From Dominique's restaurant. Dominique brought us soup. Woody's provided blankets, and and, you know, Christmas Eve, we always had a big party for homeless people with a big dinner and a talent show, and it was always a very special night for us. So this Christmas Eve, we not only had all that, but we had a hotel for homeless people to move into. And it was magical. I mean, it was absolutely magical. And so, you know, we got the hotel, and it was great. And you know, the renovation went on, the building went on for a while with the help of DC government and the federal government, and we were able to move in a few months later. Just when Oliver was ready to tear down the building.
And now come to the shelter at 2nd and D, and sort of the dynamics of how that came about. Because at one point, if I remember, you guys thought you were going to get it, but the Reagan administration said that you couldn't, and that's when the whole fast.
That was we were there for the winter, and but when it came to be spring, what were we going to do with, you know, we had hundreds of people staying in the building, and we couldn't just throw them out in the street because the calendar changed.
Right.
And so we decided we wanted to keep the building instead of turning it back over to the federal government to auction off.
You just made that decision.
Yeah. Yeah,
we're going to keep this joint.
Right, exactly. and it was, I mean, it's a building.
It's huge.
It's the old Federal City College. Mm-hmm. It takes a full city block, 187,000 square feet mm-hmm. in that building. Mm-hmm. And not only were we going to keep it, but we wanted the Reagan administration to renovate it.
Uh-huh.
And so we did a fast, and they ultimately agreed to renovate it. And then we got on to the renovating, and they didn't really want to create a model shelter. They wanted to just create a bunch of barracks, you know. And that wasn't good enough because we wanted a model shelter where we could have services and, mm-hmm. A full service facility.
Mm-hmm.
And so that meant a little more arguing. They tried to throw us out and we wouldn't leave. We barricaded the building.
Yeah.
They were going to try and force us out. So we put up iron bars on the front of the building mm-hmm. so they couldn't get in.
Yeah.
And then we went around the back and, the manhole covers where the water valves are.
Yeah.
We put a bunch of old clothes from our clothing room in there and then covered it with cement so they couldn't turn the water off.
Yeah.
And we were in there, and they kept threatening to come in and take us out. And we said, okay, try.
Yeah. Yeah.
We're here.
Yeah.
And eventually they agreed to turn it into the model shelter.
Yeah.
But
you know what, Carol? This is all just kind of rolls off your back so much. And you just said, then there was the fast, mm-hmm. and then they agreed. Well, there was a point, if I'm remembering properly, where, you guys were going to get evicted. And you and Mitch went on an extended fast.
That, I think you're thinking of the fast that was a couple years later. That was the second Ronald Reagan election.
Yes.
That was a different fast. We were trying to get housing built because
uh-huh.
our building was full
uh-huh.
and there was no affordable housing for people to go to.
Yeah. That's right. That's right.
Yeah. So we were trying to get affordable housing. And that was a pretty long fast. I fasted for 48 days on water.
Yeah. And I remember pictures of you guys. So tell us about that.
Well, my current state of affairs, the blimp that I am these days, I put on all kinds of weight because my metabolism was just destroyed.
Uh-huh.
When I went to the hospital, my blood pressure was 80/0, uh-huh. and I almost didn't live through it.
Uh-huh. So you fasted 48 days just on water?
Just on water, yeah.
Uh-huh.
And there were several of us, but I was in the worst shape of anybody, and I went to the hospital and, obviously survived, but, have a lot of physical issues as a result.
As a result of that?
Yeah, yeah.
Uh-huh. So that you still are affected by today?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Your metabolism is just connected to everything,
And so that commitment, we need another word. That goes beyond commitment, but the purpose there was to say what?
Fasting, to use militaristic terms, is like the nuclear weapon of social resistance.
Mm-hmm.
After you have tried letter writing, after you have tried, lobbying and protests and everything else, the last thing you do is put risk your health.
Yeah.
I was talking to your producer, about this, and social change is such a it's hard, and it doesn't come easy,
mm-hmm.
and it doesn't come quickly.
Mm-hmm.
People think they're going to go out and protest a few times and everything's going to be great, and it's not.
Yeah.
I always think about it as equalizing the dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
When you deal with the United States government, you come to the table as an unequal.
Mm-hmm.
Sure. They have the power, they have the money, they have the guns,
mm-hmm.
they have everything. You have nothing.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have power, you don't have money, you don't have guns,
mm-hmm.
for the most part.
Sure.
At least a grassroots group like we were.
Mm-hmm.
And so you have to find a way to create an equal dialogue,
mm-hmm.
because change can't come if you're not equals at the table.
Mm-hmm.
So what we bring to the table is our bodies, our freedom, our lives.
Moral authority.
And that is what we have on our side of the table,
mm-hmm.
which is stronger than their guns and their power and everything else.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing is that the thing politicians hate the most or the thing they value the most is their reputation.
Right.
The thing they hate the most is being embarrassed.
Mm-hmm.
And so it may not be the height of nonviolence, but we would also find ways to embarrass people,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know, at one point, there was a very conservative, and I can't remember his name, I don't know why it's escaping me, but he was a Jeff Sessions kind of Republican from a southern state.
Okay.
And we went to his office and served them with an eviction notice because we were done, and took all his furniture out into the hall before the police got there. You know, you have to be kind
yeah.
of very creative.
Yeah.
Another time, the first Ronald Reagan tax cuts
mm-hmm.
Were the Kemp-Roth bill.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, everybody was going to get a bigger piece of the pie. And
yeah.
the truth was that
yeah.
nobody was getting a bigger piece of pie
yeah.
of the pie.
Yeah.
It was just like
yeah.
Trump's tax
yeah,
cuts.
Their cliche was trickle-down economics.
Yeah, 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 right, mm-hmm. right. So the first 10% tax cut, the Kemp-Roth bill, was you know, going to be celebrated because
yeah.
Everybody was going to get a bigger piece of the pie.
Yeah.
They had a 17-foot, 6-inch apple pie made by Mrs. Smith's.
Yeah.
And if you went down to the mall, to the Sylvan Theater by the Washington Monument, you could get a piece of apple pie.
Yeah, right.
And they were making all of these ridiculous statements.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they had all
mm-hmm.
Kemp wasn't there, but Roth was.
Right.
And he was making his statement. And we had, at the same time, just received a donation of very large business suits.
Yeah.
And so I was up on the hill one day, so I saw this sign, you know, advertising, get a bigger piece of the pie. So
yeah.
I took it down, I ran home, and I said, we got to do something about this. And,
yeah.
and our friend Chris Matthews had called us and said, you got to do something about this stupid thing that's happening. This is the next day.
Mm-hmm.
So we called some friends and we
is this the Chris Matthews, the MSNBC
yeah,
Chris
yeah,
Matthews?
Yeah, this is when he worked for Tip O'Neill,
uh-huh.
right?
Okay, okay.
So anyway, we both had this, anyway, by the time I got home, they had the whole event planned. So
mm-hmm.
we our guys, five of our people, men and women, were going to dress in these business suits,
yeah.
stuff them out with pillows and, uh-huh. you know, anything they could figure
yeah.
out to stuff. But they each had a name tag
yeah.
that had one of Ronald Reagan's rich friends on
okay,
it.
Okay.
And they all had stogies.
Yeah.
And they were the fat cats.
Yeah.
And just when Senator Roth was speaking,
yeah.
they jumped onto the stage and into the pie.
Oh, my God.
And they were sitting in the pie was so big that
yeah.
the police had to go into the pie to get them out. and so there's this great picture on the,
yeah.
from the New York Times with
yeah.
this guy being dragged out of the pie. And
yeah.
they were saying, it's all for me, it's all for me.
Yeah.
They became known as the Apple Pie Five.
Yeah.
And
I want to go back just a moment to that fast. You 48 days. Were you committed to the point where you would have died?
Well, you know, on the Friday before the fast ended on like a Sunday or Monday,
yeah.
On a Monday, I think. The Friday before, I'd called Mitch because I was staying up at one of our staff houses,
yeah.
and he was down at the shelter. And I said, I don't think I can finish this, you know, because I was in bad shape, and I
yeah.
knew it. I was in the final stages. I mean, I'd done some research on with Mitch's first fast
yeah.
to find out what happens to you,
yeah.
you know. And I got in touch with the Mays prison in Ireland, where the Irish pastors
mm-hmm.
Had died, to find out what happened to them. And so I knew what was happening to me,
yeah.
and I got their research,
mm-hmm.
And I knew I was close to dying. And I said, Mitch. So Mitch, I said, Mitch, I don't think I can finish this. And he said, oh, come on, you can't give up now. And I was just like, but I might die. And he's like, oh, no, you don't want to finish. You'll be sorry.
Yeah.
And so I finished it. So I was ready to quit, but
mm-hmm.
he kept me going. I think if I died, he would have been really very sad.
Yeah. But you got the you accomplished your goal because you all got the building.
Well, this was about legislation, and
mm-hmm.
it was a limited period of time. We
mm-hmm.
we were fasting 48 days prior to the election,
mm-hmm.
so we must have ended it on Monday
mm-hmm.
Or Tuesday.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it was a an interesting time.
Yeah. Now, you hold the distinction, if I remember correctly. Mitch passed away, it was 1990.
Yes.
Mitch passed away in 1990. If I remember correctly, you hold the distinction, at least at that time, I don't know what has happened since, of being the first person to be married.
Oh.
Once, one half of the equation, Mitch was dead.
Right.
But you got married.
Right.
To Mitch.
Yes.
After he was dead.
After he died. Yeah, we're not the first person. I'm sure it's been done before.
Oh.
But I don't know of anybody who's ever done it. It made a great bar story, but you know, back in the day. But you know, we were tax resistors.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't pay taxes. We didn't file taxes. We were not tax exempt.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't earn any money either. You know, we got room and board in exchange for the work that we did. We didn't receive any money living at CCMV. But Mitch did a lot of public speaking for which he was paid.
Right.
And because we weren't tax exempt, they couldn't give the money to us. We didn't exist legally.
Uh-huh.
So they had to give the money to him.
Uh-huh.
And then when CBS did the movie, they paid him a lot of money, and he just turned the check over to CCNB.
Right.
But again, CCNB didn't exist legally.
Yeah.
And so the IRS decided they were going to come after him.
Uh-huh.
He would go up to Congress and say, we're tax resistors, we don't pay taxes.
Yeah.
And Tom DeLay got a little sick of that and called the IRS and put the IRS on him.
Uh-huh.
So they were coming after us for employee taxes. But we didn't pay employees, so there weren't any.
Yeah.
But then they were coming after him personally.
Uh-huh.
And at the time of his death, he owed a whole bunch of money in back taxes,
right,
even though he had never personally benefited from the money that he earned, either as a speaker or with the making of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
So at the time of his death, there were also some lawsuits that were out there. There was an inheritance that he was getting from somebody, you know, who wanted to pass it on to CCMV. So in order to keep the IRS from claiming his money, our attorneys said that there's a law in D.C. that says if you're a legal spouse, you can claim a family allowance for burial costs and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And so the burial or the family allowance was exactly what the family allowance was, as it turns out. I think it's like $10,000, at least it was back then.
Mm-hmm.
And the only way I could claim it for CCMV was if we were legally married.
Mm-hmm.
So we went to court and had me declared his legal spouse after he died, a year after he died, and so I became his wife. Legally, I was able to claim that money and then turn it all over to CCMV.
You have had a fascinating life.
It's been interesting.
Okay. Now, so when did you form Hope House DC?
Well, I left CCMV in 1994, and February 4th, 1994, so however many years ago, I went to work. I did a couple of things. I went to work for Sojourners again and worked at the magazine. And I also did political commentary for WAMU Radio.
Mm-hmm.
And I started writing about Lorton closing and what was happening to families. I interviewed a number of families and just really felt like...
For any newcomers to the area, she said Lorton closing. Lorton was a prison which many D.C. residents would go when they were convicted.
Right.
It's down in Lorton, Virginia.
Okay. Right. Was. Now it's closed.
Right, correct.
And D.C. inmates, I mean, that's a longer story than we want to get into, right?
Yeah.
But Lorton closed, and these families are just being torn apart by incarceration. The first inmates were shipped to Youngstown, Ohio, and that was a complete disaster. I mean, there were like 20-some stabbings and killings, and in the first 6 months, the prison was open.
Yeah.
And so, it was very bad.
Mm-hmm.
And I was writing about that, and I finally just said enough. You know, I sold everything I owned and moved to Youngstown, Ohio at age 50 with nothing, you know, but a small grant from, God bless them, the Kafritz Foundation.
Yeah.
and went to sit on the doorstep of the prison to get programs in there, at least. And so the first program we did was in 1999, which was our video conference program, which is going on right now. Another one is going on right now, where we do video conferences. We Skype now with fathers and children. So the dads are in prison and down in North Carolina, and the kids are here in D.C. and are in the D.C. area, and we pick them up, bring them to our office, and they do a Skype conference with their dad for an hour.
Yeah.
They do homework, they deal with family issues. all kinds of cool stuff. But after that, I couldn't find any really creative programs for fathers. And so I started looking at women's facilities.
For incarcerated fathers,
mm-hmm. yeah. Mm-hmm. So I started looking at women's facilities. I went to Bedford Hills in New York. They had a cool summer camp program where children come to spend a week with their moms. Mm-hmm. So moms do that, why can't dads?
Yeah.
And so we started the first summer camp in Youngstown for dads.
Mm-hmm. This is under the auspices of Hope House.
Yes, uh-huh. yeah. Mm-hmm. We still do camps. We've done 40-some summer camps since then. Yeah. For years, we were the only summer camp behind bars
right.
in the nation for fathers in prison.
Right.
There were other ones for mothers, but not for fathers. We've trained a few groups to do them now in various parts of the country, but mm-hmm. They're still rare. And then we started a reading program where we record fathers reading books to their children, and mm-hmm. we've recorded about 20,000 books since 2000.
And when you say recorded 20,000 books, meaning that, you know, your Hope House mm-hmm. has been the facilitator to get children to come to see their fathers or to be read to.
Read to by their fathers. So we go into prisons with recorders and a library of children's books.
Yeah.
Dads choose a book,
yeah.
And they're all brand new, beautiful brand new books.
Uh-huh.
They record the books,
yeah.
and then we download them onto CDs,
yeah.
and they get the book and the recording,
uh-huh.
And we've done 20,000 of those.
And then you take that to the child?
No, we mail it.
Uh-huh.
We mail
that's
it.
That's what I'm saying,
but
you get it to the child.
Yeah. We ship them, and you know, we're getting ready for a mailing coming soon, but we work with law firms to do that.
Yeah.
D.C. law firms have been great uh-huh. In terms of mailing out the books for us,
uh-huh.
and so that we take, like, you know, we're going to Alston and Byrd next week,
yeah.
and we will, they'll get a crew together, they'll address the envelopes, and then mail them for us. Yeah.
And what have you seen, what has been the impact of that?
We do surveys mm-hmm. of the mothers with the reading program.
Mm-hmm.
And what we hear from the mothers, like, the survey has to do with how is this affecting your child's education? Because
mm-hmm.
we want the fathers to play a positive role in the lives of their kids.
Yeah.
So we find that I think it's like 92% of the mothers report that their children are reading more as a result of getting books from their dads.
Mm.
50% tell us their kids' grades have improved. We're just in the midst of doing a research project with Virginia Commonwealth University and the Bureau of Prisons.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we're getting some really wonderful results back from that.
Mm.
This is of our dads
yeah.
who are in summer camp, and we're looking at recidivism rates there.
Mm-hmm.
We've done some research projects, again, with VCU and the BOP in terms of participants in the reading program.
Mm-hmm.
And they are twice as likely, the inmates, the dads, are twice as likely not to have incident reports, four times as likely not to have serious incident reports as people not involved in the program.
As a result of?
Well, I don't know it's a result of,
yeah.
but it's that's the stat right there,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
And we're just starting a brand new project. We're getting ready
Before you tell me about that,
yeah.
Before you tell me about that, these camps that you set up,
uh-huh.
Describe how that happens. You bring these kids somewhere near the prison.
Well, let me start. The dads have to qualify for the camp. It starts with the dad.
Yeah.
They have to apply for camp. Their children have to be between 9 and 14.
Okay.
They have to have clear conduct, no incident reports for a year,
mm-hmm.
Et cetera.
Yeah.
Once the dads apply, then we reach out to the mothers,
uh-huh.
and the mothers have to say yes.
Okay.
Then the kids come to camp. So
yeah.
we're inside the prison 5 hours a day for 5 days.
With
the children and dads,
mm-hmm.
no moms, just the children and dads spending time getting to know each other and rebuilding relationships that have been broken
yeah.
by incarceration.
Yeah.
Sometimes we've had children who've met their fathers for the first time in their lives at summer camp.
Yeah.
Those are really powerful camps. You know, when that happens, it's just, it just kind of rips your heart out.
Yeah.
But we do art. It's an art-based camp, so we
mm-hmm.
do art. The kids and dads work on art together.
Mm-hmm.
We leave the prison at 3. We go swimming and do all kinds of campy stuff, you know, campfires and s'mores and all the things that kids do at camp. But the most important thing that happens is the time the kids spend with the dads.
Yeah.
And that's clear. I mean, we had one camp where we couldn't go into the prison because there had been an incident, and the kids were just really upset because all they want to do is see their dads.
Sure.
You know?
Sure.
So.
Did I hear, I'm trying to put this story together, that there was a, in one of those camps situations, did you, was there a camp arranged and there was supposed to be, I'm trying to think there was a, if a, a father passed away,
it was after camp, but we had a father who met his child at camp for the first time in his life. He adored this child, right. And the child was in camp for 6 years, and you know every summer camp. Every mm-hmm. summer camp, you know, this father lived for camp.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
He was a real problem person in the prison.
Inmate. Yeah.
Until camp came, uh-huh. and he became a model prisoner, so he could spend time with his kids, his son.
Yeah.
And when his child aged out of camp at 14 after
right.
6 years,
right.
and the dad was getting ready to come home. Mm-hmm. He'd been locked up almost all his life, and since he was like 12, you know. He'd used drugs, he was an older guy,
yeah.
His liver had been ruined with all the bad stuff he'd put in his body.
Right.
And in October he died of cirrhosis before he could get home. The one thing he was living for was to see his son play soccer. That's all he wanted, once. He wanted
yeah.
one day on the street to see his son, you know, play soccer, and he didn't make it, but he died. But, I mean, and that's a terrible story, but the good news is that that son and that dad, that son has a legacy of good things with his father.
Yeah.
Not my dad died in prison.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And as sad as it was, I was so grateful that we were able to play that role
mm-hmm.
in the life of that father and son, you
mm-hmm.
know. And the son is in college now and doing great.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, he knew his dad.
Yeah. Yeah.
And there's another story. Let me just tell you this real quick. Because
mm-hmm.
it really it's so important. There was another girl who met her father at camp for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
And she was in camp for 6 years too. But you know, on the first day when she was going to see her father for the first time,
mm-hmm.
you know, I will never forget this. And her dad was at the back of the room because he was really nervous and
yeah.
anxiety ridden.
Yeah.
And she saw him across the room and ran, just bolted across the room, jumped into his arms, and you know, there wasn't a dry eye in the room.
Yeah.
Fast forward 6 years, I'm taking her home from camp because she lived a ways away, and I would pick her up and drive her home. And so we were talking about that first day of camp. And she told me that she had never even seen a picture of her father before that day. I mean, so she didn't know what he looked like.
Uh-huh.
And I said, well, how did you know it was him? And she said, I looked into his face and I saw me in his face and I knew it was him. I mean.
Wow.
I cried when she told me that story.
Yeah.
And I was reminded of why we do what we do, so that children can see the face of their fathers.
Yeah.
You know, and know the face of their fathers.
Yeah. Is there any sort of resource that you have that in any way tracks the child after they transition out from 14? And why is that? Why do they limit that age?
Past 14, like the distance between 9 and 14 is really a big distance. And when you've got kids together with that wide an age range, it just, they don't gel.
Oh, I see.
Number one. Number two, at 14, kids are starting to get, well, as they say, smell themselves.
Yeah.
And
so it's not, so if I can understand, it's not the prison's rule?
No, it's our rule.
Uh-huh.
It's our rule. We've taken kids 15 and they didn't work out. Last year we tried an 8-year-old.
Yeah.
And, you know, he was just too young. There's
yeah.
a distance between 8 and 9 that something cognitive
yeah.
happens
uh-huh.
between that those two ages. And that makes, I don't know, 9-year-olds are good
uh-huh.
and able to deal with it and all
uh-huh.
that. I mean, this is a very emotional thing for kids. And
yeah.
and so there's something that happens at 9
mm-hmm.
that they're able, and at, you know, 14. And then we hire kids back. The girl that I told you about,
yeah.
She's one of our camp counselors now.
Uh-huh.
And so we hire the kids back as camp counselors.
Yeah.
And not all of them, obviously, but and tracking the kids is another issue.
Mm-hmm.
We keep track of the kids as long as we can,
mm-hmm.
But you know, they're mostly low-income kids who move a lot, mm-hmm. numbers change. Mm-hmm. Unless someone calls us with the number,
yeah.
we don't know what happened, and they mm-hmm. disappear. Mm-hmm. And we run into them, and, you know, we were able to find them from time to time and keep yeah. track of them. And we just had an event, actually, last May,
yeah.
Where we honored, well, you were there, the children of prisoners, and all the achievements they have. And most of those kids had aged out of camp. But very few of them actually come to camp anymore.
Yeah.
So we track and we keep track of them as much as we can. And that was a pretty powerful event, wasn't it?
Yes, that was, you know? that was absolutely extraordinary.
Yeah, I mean, we have one girl who has a $250,000 scholarship to GW University,
yeah.
you know?
Yeah.
And a lot of our kids are in college and doing great.
Mm-hmm. The event you're talking about again, I saw something in that room that just, I don't know how you quantify it, but it was so special mm-hmm. that these kids felt a connection to love. You know how when it says, mm-hmm. when you say, you know, the African proverb, it takes a village to raise a child.
Right.
What I felt in that room that night was that there was an, you know, kids don't tend to be, high on their list is not necessarily an outward display
right.
of appreciation.
Yeah.
But you certainly could see that night, that what was going on was making a serious difference in their lives.
Right. And weren't the parents proud of their kids?
Yeah.
You know, And there's so much said and written about children and prisoners, you know,
yeah.
and the fact is they're just kids,
yeah.
you know, and they have struggles and heartaches, but they're just kids in the end, mm-hmm. and they need summer camp, and they need their dads, and they need their moms, and they need, you know, the kind of support that every child needs.
Yeah. So in order to do this, I mean, with all of your goodwill, you know, being the ultimate the good Samaritan, this stuff here takes money.
Right.
So how are you and how is Hope House able to survive?
Well, you know, I learned how not to spend money at CCNV, you know.
That's important.
Yeah, yeah. And you know, it's carried over to Hope House. We have never had a budget over in you know, since 1998, we've never had a budget more than $300,000. And that is salaries and everything else. And we get foundation money, some individual grants. We've never taken government money, except we get a DC Arts Commission grant for summer camp.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't take federal grants. I mean, we applied once and it was just a nightmare. Mm-hmm. I mean, part of the problem is what groups tend to do is get reliant on federal grants.
Yeah.
And when that money goes away like it's about to,
mm-hmm.
those groups collapse on themselves.
Mm-hmm.
You also have to become the agency that gives you the money, and it kind of puts bonds around you that are mm-hmm. not that stifle, I think, your organization's mission a lot of times.
Mm-hmm.
And that's part of my old, you know, tax resistor
yeah.
self coming out
yeah,
there.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, yeah. So what is the mission?
The mission is to help families stay connected through the incarceration experience, to support mm. families on the outside, and to raise consciousness about the issue of family incarceration.
Mm-hmm. How can the community help you?
Well,
how can the viewers help you?
Okay. Well, money. I mean, obviously, money is always an issue. We're doing okay now. You mm-hmm. know, mm-hmm. But we're about to launch a program that has some funding available, but not the full program funded. That's our homework project,
mm-hmm.
and where dads help. Well, it's a longer story, but we need books, brand new, not used books, new mm-hmm. books. We only use new books in the program because mm-hmm. I don't think that poor children should receive used gifts just because they're poor.
Mm-hmm.
So at Christmas time, we only give new gifts to kids.
Mm-hmm.
In our reading program, we only give used new books
mm-hmm.
for a father to give to his child this
mm-hmm.
gift
mm-hmm.
of a new book,
mm-hmm.
not a used book.
Mm-hmm.
And we appreciate all the offers of people who want to give us used books, but mm-hmm. we only use brand new ones.
Mm-hmm.
Politics and Prose is great about, you know, they have a book drive that's going on over there for us year round,
yeah.
and you can buy books and leave them at Politics and Prose and they'll get them to us.
Mm-hmm.
And Christmas gifts, yeah. School supplies and backpacks, you know, back to school. Right. Because a lot of our work is done outside the D.C. area because there are no prisoners in the D.C. area any longer. Mm-hmm. I mean, we do a program out at the D.C. jail, but there really aren't any prisons around here that house D.C. inmates. So we have to go outside the D.C. inmates to record books for summer camp. Our parties in D.C. are the only ones for the kids, are the only ones, only activity we actually have here for volunteers. Yes.
What's the reaction of the prisons when you go? Because, I mean, you know, you think of prisons, you think hard, cold, slamming doors.
Right.
Wardens banging on the bars.
Right. You know, the prisons, I have to say, have been great. You know, mm-hmm. once we had a track record, we were able to really prove that we could do this and that it benefits the prison. And you know, when we first go into a prison, there's a lot of skepticism, you know, about us. Mm-hmm. But when people there watch the fathers be transformed by their children, I think our kids save our dads' lives. You know,
can you give me an example of that?
Well, the example is the guy I told you about who died in prison.
Yeah.
I mean, his son, having the love of his son, was the most important thing. It completely transformed him. Mm-hmm. I mean, and he became a leader, a positive leader in the prison. I mean, he was great. I sat next to, I was at a retirement dinner for a prison staff person a couple of weeks ago. And I sat next to a counselor on one of the units, and she told me that people who participate in the program came back changed, that they were just different prisoners, mm-hmm. you know, after that. Mm-hmm. And their whole focus was their kids. Mm-hmm. So I mean, it just transforms, and the children, their grades improved, the relationship between them and their father changes, and then when he comes home, you know, we know that the dads stay in touch with us, at least in the beginning, mm-hmm. and they stay involved in the lives of their children. I mean, they're not going off doing stuff they're not supposed to do for the most part. I mean, the recidivism rates that we're seeing from the initial numbers on this research project that's been going on for 4 years are astounding. Mm-hmm. I mean, just astounding and shocking even to me. I mean, I almost fell off my chair when they showed me. We can't release them yet because they're not final.
Yeah.
But they were pretty amazing. Mm-hmm. And we're hoping that the new homework project really just kind of expands the base and the depth of relationship. Mm-hmm. Can I tell you about this? Because I'm so excited.
Oh, please do.
So we just finished the curriculum and submitted it. And so it's going to be a project where we facilitate homework circles for fathers in the prison. And we'll have a specialist going in to work with them. And they will determine a topic for the week. Mm-hmm. It may be cultural, it may mm-hmm. be current events, mm-hmm. You know, whatever strikes them.
Right.
And there'll be some reading material that goes with it. So it'll enhance reading with the kids. Mm-hmm. The kids, or a video, you know. Right. And the purpose is for the fathers to the fathers will then create questions around an article, a current event, a video, and send the federal system has email. They'll send the questions home to the kids, mm-hmm. and it'll create a dialogue between. That's the vision. This is brand new. And the vision is that it will create a better dialogue, a deeper dialogue between fathers and their children. Mm-hmm. I mean, who knows this conversation with a teenager?
Yeah.
How was your day? Fine. What'd you do? Nothing.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, sure.
Hopefully, it will create a better conversation between fathers and children.
Mm-hmm.
And children, and the fathers will be able to teach their children about values, mm-hmm. about critical thinking, mm-hmm. you know, about all the things that they're not learning in school. And our fathers can do that. Now, we're setting it up as a mentoring program, you know, because I have long believed that fathers in prison can mentor their own children. Well, the federal government has spent millions and millions of dollars on mentoring programs for children of prisoners. And I'm sure they helped a lot of kids.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, when I was this White House Champion of Change thing, I got invited to meetings and I kept standing up and saying, but can we put some of that money towards helping fathers mentor their own children? Because they can do it.
Right.
And it never went anywhere. So we're trying to create a program to prove that our fathers are good dads. They made mistakes, but that doesn't mean they're a bad dad. And to enable them to mentor their children from behind bars.
Uh-huh. Do you, what kind of, have you had any issues where you've had to, you've matched up the child with the dad, mm-hmm. and there's been any kind of negative ramifications?
Not that I can think of, mm-hmm. Offhand. Not that I can think of. I mean, it's hard when the kids have to say goodbye. And we had a child, we did a camp for a few years in Maryland's Supermax facility, mm-hmm. which is where Death Row used to be. Yeah. And it's a very...
Where's that?
In Cumberland, Maryland.
Cumberland.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
North Branch Correctional Institution. Mm-hmm. And we had one girl who didn't want to come. She ended up coming, but she couldn't stand to see her father in prison. And you know, the camps are not out on the compound. Yeah. They're in the visiting room generally. In this yeah. case, it was in the gym, so it wasn't a, and we were the only ones in the room.
Yeah.
But this little girl was just very upset when she saw her father locked up that way. And she ended up coming back, and she's still a part of it. We see her all the time, you mm-hmm. know. We're not in that facility any longer, but we mm-hmm. see her all the time. Mm-hmm. And she's still a part of Hope House. But that was sad, you know, because she was very upset having to leave her dad and having to leave him in that hard place. Yeah. I mean, it's a tough place. That is the toughest prison I've ever been in.
Yeah. Carol, I follow you on Facebook. And I see some of your postings, and it's like you're the Energizer Bunny. I mean, you're at one part of the top part of the state of Maryland, and then you're in West Virginia, and you're in North Carolina, and you're taking supplies to your home from your home, West Virginia, right?
Yes.
West Virginia.
My cabin in the mountains. So.
Yeah. You're coming here to D.C. What is it that drives you to do the kind of, because you do a lot of work. It's a lot of work, a lot of energy, a lot of heavy lifting.
Well, I don't do so much lifting anymore. I used to. But, when I talk to young people a lot of times, I asked them, what are you going to do to change the world today? How is the world going to be a different place because you got out of bed this morning? Mm-hmm. And I like to live my life in a way that means that by the end of the day, I will have, the world will be different because I got up that morning. Mm-hmm. Which isn't to say I do all the work of Hope House because, yeah. you know, there's two of us. Yeah. Brenda does a lot of, she's our family outreach coordinator, she does a lot of work with mm. the families too, mm. but this is my own commitment. This is yeah. my, and I wouldn't, right. and at CCMV, you know, we were always very careful to say, you know, CCMV is a community.
Yeah.
But I think it's important that each of us make an impact on the world so that the world is different because we walk the earth mm-hmm. at the end of our days, mm-hmm. you know? Mm-hmm. So that's part of it. Part of it is religious. You know, I came at this originally as a faith, when I started working with homeless people back in the 70s, you know, it was because it was a faith commitment. Mm-hmm. Feed the hungry, house mm-hmm. the homeless, visit the sick and the prisoner. And when I started Hope House, someone said, well, you worked your way through Matthew 25 because, you know, I ran the soup kitchen, I ran the medical yeah. clinic, I ran the shelter, yeah. you know, yeah. So now I got to do the prisoner and then I'm done, you know, mm-hmm. so this is it.
mm-hmm. To the viewers who have relatives, loved ones that are incarcerated, huh. you know, it's obviously a difficult matter to deal with.
Yes.
What do prisoners most need?
I don't know that I can quantify that because each person in prison is such an individual, you know, and each family is different, mm-hmm. you know. A lot of times families have been supportive of their loved ones in prison, and they come out and they go back to prison, mm-hmm. you know, and they get just tired, and I understand that, you know, it can be very frustrating. And it's hard for me to say, well, or pass judgment on them because they give up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, mm-hmm. I get that.
Mm-hmm.
But a lot of folks, you know, want to come home and they want to do better and they want to do the right thing when they get out and come back to their families. And, you know, I think if that's the case, then try and be as supportive as you can. But I get it if you can't, you know. The same with homeless people, yeah. You know. A lot of families of homeless people want to be supportive of them.
Yeah.
But they've been around the block so many times with whoever it is that they're dealing with that they just can't do anymore. I get that too.
We've got 30 seconds. We've been talking about some heavy stuff right here. You have a bouncing bundle of joy. That is, you became a grandma.
Well, for the fifth time.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, but yeah. I'm talking about this recent one.
Yeah,
that was a real special miracle.
Yeah, he's pretty special. He was born early, spent 5 months in the NICU at Children's Hospital, and he gets joy.
Yeah.
You know?
I saw you light up.
Yeah.
I'm glad you did.
Thank you
so much, Carol, for joining us today. Folks, that wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Goodbye and God bless.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.